before we begin, can we have any declarations of interest? Thank you, Chair. I work for the NHS and my son is a GP in the NHS.
It also works for the NHS.
Any other declarations of interest? Can I just confirm that no members are subject to any whip, party whip, this meeting tonight? Right, thank you. First, we have the minutes from the meeting that we held on the 1st of July. Has everyone seen a copy of those minutes? Are there any corrections that need to be made? No? In which case, is everybody happy with those minutes? Can you agree with the record? Thank you. So our meeting tonight is just a single item on the agenda, which is the urgent care transformation. If you recall, at the last meeting, we looked purely at the consultation process. That meeting was not in a position to look at the actual decision that had been made by the CCG. However, we now are in a position to review that decision, and you will have all had the report. So first of all, if I could ask the officers who are present, those who are going to make a presentation, what three of you down? Where are we starting? Is that to go? Right.
Thank you, Councillor Nolan and colleagues, and thank you for inviting us here this evening to talk through the urgent care transformation and the process which we got to and the decisions which were agreed at the governing body of the 9th of July. For those who heard this presentation last week, I apologise. It's a similar presentation with just some additional information to help you based on some of the questions and queries that we have had over the time. So as you know, we had an urgent care consultation from September through to December of last year, which, as you've heard me say before, we all recognise that it attracted quite a lot of interest from our population, with quite a considerable number of petitions submitted to the CCG, over 45,000, and over 1,900 responses to our survey. And again, you'll have heard me say previously that I welcome such interest because I think it demonstrates the depth of interest that our population have in the delivery of urgent care, but also how absolutely wedded they feel to some of the services which are provided within their community. Our aim ultimately and our overall key desire is to improve the delivery of urgent healthcare to our population and to meet our constitutional standards, and it's crucial that we do so. And therefore, in doing so, in consulting as part of our constitutional requirements, we felt it necessary to demonstrate that we were keen to engage with our population but also to take on board that feedback. The model of care which was approved at the governing body, you can see there on the slide, has four components to it. The first component is the 24-hour urgent treatment centre to be based at the Arrow Park site. This was agreed at the February governing body of 2018, and it's based on a number of clinical parameters and national standards. Some of those clinical parameters are around the swift delivery of ED consultant review, the swift access to diagnostics should a patient deteriorate. There's multiple others, but they're just some of the key reasons around why it was decided to locate that at the Arrow Park site. The second outcome from our meeting was that of the retention of all age walk-in access. And you may recall from the consultation that we went out that there was a proposal that we would have it limited to 0 to 19. But based on the depth of feedback that came back to us, we felt it important to listen to our population and to retain all age access. Third recommendation is the replacement of two of the minor injury services with same-day access to GP and nurse appointments. And the fourth is the delivery of dressing and wound care to meet the local demand of patients within the Wharton area. And these can be pre-booked. So at present, patients have to wait some time when they turn up with the dressing. This enables and allows a much more streamlined delivery for our patients so that they can attend at an appointment time. What we also need to be mindful of is that we are looking at delivering services within our community. There's a lot of talk about place-based care, about population health, about left shift, moving out of the hospital into our community, which is why we had such a robust consultation and why we were really keen to take on all the feedback that's come back. Consultation feedback, as you'll see, is on the slide above. It's really important that you understand that we demonstrate that we are responsive in our analysis of public feedback and that this was used in our final model of care. The public feedback was very focused on the retention of all-age walk-in access, as I said, and this has impacted on our considerations, and we took that on board very much so. And the final model of care includes all-age access to the three sites. During the consultation, we asked the public what was important to them when thinking about their urgent care facilities, where urgent care facilities should be based in the community, and we listened to this feedback. The other thing that we did when looking at the feedback was that we went out to an independent body in order to analyse the feedback which we got. And we felt that really crucial to demonstrate transparency so that we wouldn't put a CCG slant on what was coming back, and we wouldn't do that, but I think it was important that we demonstrated that transparency and having an independent body review that. We also engaged with the clinic at the Northwest Clinical Senate and took on board their considerations, which we continue to do so at the moment. Now, looking at the key considerations, we as commissioners hope that we can demonstrate that we have listened and are considering the key following messages. A, the retention of all age walk-in access locally. And this came out really quite strongly throughout the consultation. What if a mother who's 20 turns up with a child and she's unwell and the child is 2 and our cutoff is 19? How do we manage that? It's crucial that a mother and a child are seen together. And we recognise that. That was just one of the comments that came back to us. People value the following three most important factors when considering where they access their urgent care within their community: distance from home, flexibility and convenience of appointments, and public transport access. And we'll come on to transport in a few moments. And the following three sites were really strongly valued by our local population: the Birkenhead Medical Centre in Birkenhead, Victoria's Central Hospital here in Wallasey, and Easton Clinic The majority of people, over 66.5%, preferred the option one, which was the 24-hour urgent treatment centre, and also feedback from our population was that they valued the proposal to be able to book a dressing appointment rather than having to turn up and wait. And looking a little bit more in depth at those key considerations, distance from home 32%, flexibility and convenience of appointments 23%, and access to public transportation 23%. So that was around the location. In terms of addressing deprivation, and I mentioned population health, and we all know that Wirral is quite diverse in socioeconomic outcomes and socioeconomic, how our patients, the poverty deprivation versus wealth. Wirral is 15 by 10 miles, a motorway running through it, and yet patients and population within 12 years longer side of that motorway versus the other. And it's really crucial that we address that at those areas and that issue of deprivation. And so we looked at that in our considerations and we extended the hours of operation for all age walk-in centres in those areas with high levels of deprivation. And that was something that we found was really crucial. So that was the Birkenhead Medical Centre will increase by 2 hours. We retained the women's at the VCH centre here in Wallasey, and we've extended access appointments locally, which means that those patients who may feel isolated, may feel fragile, may feel frail, due to geography, will not have long distances to them. And again, we'll come on to the transport and mentioned it here. For facilities being replaced by GP extended access, we believe there is sufficient provision in these areas to minimise the need for additional travel. What we mean by that is, I know that here in the November meeting, there was a lot of concern around patients having to access the Arrow Park site because that is the location of the urgent treatment centre. And I'll say it again, our aim is that only patients who clinically need to access the Arrow Park site should access that. And so transport from their home to Arrow Park hopefully won't have an impact, because the reason for ensuring that we have robust delivery within the community is that our patients can access it within the community. during the urgent care consultation to ensure that where possible any potential changes will have a minimal impact on the residents. So we are very mindful of the transport concerns that have been raised by yourselves, but not only yourselves but by also by our population, and there was feedback during the consultation around that. An internal CCG transport working group has been established, and that includes representation from Merseytravel and local councillors. And this group has met during the urgent care consultation and has also worked alongside Merseytravel. And we also, whilst we don't commission transport, we're not abrogating our responsibility to deliver health and care to our patients. And so we're very keen to work alongside yourselves and our transport colleagues in how we can address that issue. And I recognise that Merseytravel are currently assessing the impact of recent changes will have and will engage with commissioners and local councils once their assessment has been completed. We also recognise there's been a lot of concern raised around the closure of Borough and Cheshire. The provision of GP extended access appointments and the specific dressing and home care, particularly for the Morton area, will mean that patients can access same time urgent care appointments. And patients will be able to book the same day appointment with the GP or a nurse. And there's the other issue that's come out more recently is the misconception that actually Gladstone and Morton surgeries are closing. The actual surgeries, which are GP-led, which have been established for many, many years, are not closing. It is the minor injury services which run alongside, which are closing. So when we look at Gladstone is currently open 4 hours per day, 5 days a week. That offers about 75 appointments per week. Over the course of the day and the week, we were asked whether there was fluctuations in the timing of the appointments, whether there was fluctuations in the day of the week, and it's approximately 13 to 15 appointments per day. What we are offering in replacement for that and for provision whilst closing that, we're offering 82 extended access appointments, which overprovides on top of the 75 appointments. We also recognise that there are a lot of pharmacies locally, and as part of our education and our delivery of care to our population, we feel that it's important, and it was raised on the last joint scrutiny meeting that we had, around educating patients around self-care and self-management and use of their local pharmacies. In terms of Morton, the delivery of the minor injuries units are open somewhat longer during the week, between 8 and 10 hours, Monday through Friday, closed on Saturday and Sunday. So that currently offers 102 appointments, which is about 17 to 21 patients per day. And again, there's no daytime variation and there's no time of day fluctuation in that. What we're offering is 90 patients per week in terms of extended access. But on top of that, we would be looking at offering, 90 patients per week are seen. We would be offering 64 appointments in terms of extended access, but also 38 nurse appointments, which is in excess of the 90 which is currently offered. So 90 are currently offered. What we're proposing is 64 additional extended access appointments and 38 dressing, which is 102, which is 12 more than is currently being offered. And when you look at the breakdown of the types of patients and the types of concerns and clinical issues that they present with, approximately 46% of those are for dressings. So again, looking at Gladstone, looking at Morton, the current provision is 75 appointments per week at Gladstone and 90 at Morton. What we're proposing is at the Gladstone site, 82 extended access appointments and 102 combined dressing and extended access appointments in the Morton area. So I hope that that helps to alleviate some of the concerns around the provision within those areas, particularly as there has been some concern around the closure of those. So in terms of next step, the summary of the next step, we hope that you feel that we have been responsive to the feedback which we have got and responsive to your concerns and queries and questions, and we're happy to take some of them. The public feedback and your feedback has been really, really crucial and really instrumental in how we deliver care and how the model that was finally agreed at the governing body. In terms of how we would roll out, it would be very much a phased approach with a very, very robust communication and engagement strategy. We would want to work with yourselves on that going forward, particularly around the naming of the community sites, because we're not allowed to call them back inside. developing a very stringent and strict implementation plan with key timeframes so that that would be delivered in a phased approach. And again, we welcome your input into that and input into communication with our population. So I'll stop there and I'm more than happy to take queries myself, Nesta and Jackie.
Thank you for that, Dr. Cameron.
People who have other urgent needs.
GPs that are not dressing. At the moment, those services aren't as led. What we are trying to provide within that local area is access to both GP or nurse, dependent upon the individual need. So there will be an enhanced access on an urgent basis within that local area, and that those individuals who contact for an urgent appointment will be directed to where their nearest available urgent appointment is, and they will be within that facility there in County area. Thank you.
Is it okay, Chair? Just Dr. Cowan wants to come in at this point, so she may have something to add.
Yeah, it's just really, I can totally thank you for the question. I think it's a very valued question, very valuable question, and I think Jeff has addressed the issue around wound care, which would be on a more chronic basis in terms of regular follow-up and ongoing follow-up, and that's something that we really want to maintain and recognise that as continuity. When you look at a breakdown of the other conditions for which patients present, they are, and I can say this from a clinical point of view and from no clinical practice, they are much more on-the-day acute problems that patients are frequently happy to see whatever healthcare professional is available to see them, whether it's an advanced nurse practitioner, a practice nurse, or a GP or a physician's associate. So it's certainly looking at those sore throat, cough, skin problems, rash, minor illness. Those types of problems tend to be patients who are more than happy to see who's available on the day, rather than maintaining that continuity. If you've got a patient who's got a wound care issue, chronic venous ulceration, problems that need that ongoing consistent approach, then what we're looking at is trying to maintain that and address that continuity, knowing that certainly a lot of our patients like to come back and see the same nurse, and they like to have their nurse because that nurse does it her way, and I like the way that nurse does it. And I think that's really crucial, that's really important, which is why we've really honed in on addressing all this. But when you look at the other conditions for which patients present, they're much more on the same type of my child has a rash, you know, which is the type of approach. So I hope that helps to address that. Thank you.
Any further questions? Thank you. Well, thank you for the presentation. I think certainly some of the issues that were raised before, I think, have been it's very reassuring to see that the locations that we were primarily concerned about are actually now likely to receive an enhanced service from what they were. I think if we were to look back over this exercise, there's sort of two key takes about how we might have not ended up in this room tonight, but I really want us to be able to look forward to what we might actually be able to achieve out of something that came from a place we'd rather not have started from, to where we might actually be able to get three steps further up the road. And for me, those two takes really are about communication and education. I think, this whole exercise has sort of demonstrated that, you can't do enough communication when these sorts of events are being planned. And when you actually work effectively with your cohort and your communities, together we can actually get to a better place. I was very taken sort of last time and just now with what Dr. Cowan had said, that the opportunities for people to access a whole range of healthcare professionals is potentially going to be greater today. And I think there's such an opportunity here if we want to take it and build on it, to start building that confidence amongst people in the community that there are lots of options. And I think, there might actually be a real opportunity as to how you meet and greet people when they arrive anywhere, in terms of directing them and giving them the confidence that they can go to see a nurse practitioner or an assistant clinician or a pharmacist or any of the plethora of things that are, we do a lot of health screening and all of these terms are new to me, and I couldn't tell you what you do versus what you do and somebody else might do. But I think there's a real opportunity to give people confidence that, that was a great experience. Next time, I'll be quite relaxed about going to make an appointment. I'll ask for an appointment with
know, some really, really good and positive communication, particularly in the sort of areas of sort of around Gladstone and Walton, where probably you've got quite a frightened community who think that, you know, life is actually going to be a little bit worse, but actually the opportunity is to say, you know, we've listened to what you've got to say and, you know, we've responded positively to it. So I think there's an opportunity there for Brian to say it.
And that was really helpful because what we did, we met with the councillors, with the nursing trials. issues with access to the Arrow Park site and also about the access around the community in localities to access urgent appointments. And we'll reinforce what Nessa said, whilst it's not health's responsibility to commission transport, we were trying to make sure that we were having a joined up conversation with the people responsible for commissioning and providing transport. We paused those groups because we'd reached as far as we could go until final recommendations and decisions were taken. But as Nessa said, we will then continue to influence a joined up conversation with the line.
As Jackie said, I was on that group, and to be quite honest, well, we sat there for three meetings with Nurse and Travel who produced heat maps, basically telling us where the buses ran when we already knew. When they ran up to 7 o'clock at night, and then when they ran after 7 o'clock at night, and on a Sunday, and after 7 o'clock at night, just blank in South Wirral and West Wirral, there was just nothing there. So how most accidents, I would have thought, would occur when you're playing football on a Sunday or when you're bouncing around the house in the evening. There isn't a bus, there isn't a train onto Arrow Park, so you're left with two options, taxi or ambulance, and most people would reach for an ambulance. I was really disappointed that basically we just got these maps and then the whole thing stopped and we didn't go any further. And I do welcome the opportunity that we're going to have, hopefully, a committee that will look at transport and health, because it's not just a health-related issue, it's an issue across the whole of Wirral. And certainly in the south of Wirral and the west of Wirral, we've got some very rural areas, very isolated communities. They don't necessarily have access to a car. Lots of elderly people who've lived there for a long, long time, don't drive, and they've got a bus once every 2 hours if it turns up.
Thank you, Councillor John. Councillor Norbury.
Sorry, Mr. Mayor.
Okay, is it covered? Any further questions?
Can I just ask about development of tree branch in terms of patients, particularly Waterloo and Ferry? Are you looking at developing that further in terms of identifying needs that people come in with?
Okay, thank you for that. I guess it's the same for anybody accessing urgent care services at the moment, and on what route that is, whether somebody walks in themselves or whether they phone 111 and are not directed to wherever they need. So there's two things, I guess, to say to the work that's being done. At the moment, we do operate a triage and assessment service. So if somebody phones through 411, for example, they are triaged on that phone, and people will know there's a new and improved offer on 111, so there's more rapid clinical assessment and advice and signposting with a prescription or whatever it might be, or a bookable appointment made for that person as they need it. Going forward, with the improvements we'll be making to urgent care, both for the urgent treatment centre but also in the community urgent care offer that we are now going to be moving forward on, we've been having a clinical modelling group looking at those pathways, and that includes that assessment and triage process, and that's been in development with clinicians from across the system, from Arrow Park, from those emergency department consultants, but also primary care GPs in the room, with some of the nurses from
That might be the nurse, that might be the physician's associate, that might be the pharmacist, that might be some paramedics working in primary care now and do some urgent care within primary care. So it comes back to your comment earlier around communication, around education. Triage is really important because actually it improves our patient journey. To ensure that they're seen by the right person means more closed episodes of care. And you'll hear that term, closed episodes of care, means that everything's done within that one appointment or one consultation or one process, rather than the to-ing and fro-ing. And, oh no, you don't need to see me, you should actually see this person. You could have gone to the pharmacy, you could have gone here. How irritating is that for people, particularly elderly people, particularly a mom with a young child? But actually, the most important thing is that patient could that person be seen by the most appropriate person. And so the introduction of our primary care network, social prescribing, physiotherapy, primary care, all of this is evolving, and it is based really around that triage model, isn't it? It's based around having more services within the community, it's based around better patient flow.
One of the things that the last meeting we touched on, and there was a lot of anxiety around, is GP and clinician generating capacity. And you, I think at that time, you told us that there were no problems. I just wondered if you've done any additional work or any more detailed workforce planning that can show us, you know, because I'm aware that nationally, as well as locally, there are acute pressures on GPs and on recruitment of these other, you know, staff as well, advanced practitioners. So have you got now some more robust, perhaps, workforce planning around that?
I can answer partly, then I can hand over to Simon Banks, because the workforce, because this is greater than primary care, this is across our whole system, and there is part of Healthy Women Workforce Programme, and obviously with the Cheshire Mersey side. In terms of, because some of the questions has been about the capacity within any extended hours, and we, you know, we've revisited it, there is capacity at the moment even. We have more appointments than people are taking up, and there's also a percentage of people not attending those appointments, which we're also working with the GPs that are providing that extended hours to make sure we can make that much slicker way of working. But again, working with the Cheshire Merseyside NHS England primary care leads for commissioning, you know, we review our workforce capacity both for Wirral and then across Cheshire Merseyside, and obviously they work on a much bigger footprint. And again, we're quite lucky on Wirral. I think it's seen as a good place to work. So we're very good at attracting people in. We've already got some physician associates that we talked about. I'm sure it was in that joint office. So we've already got some of them on Wirral already. There's plans nationally to train them. First contact paramedics in 2 years' time that will also go into GP practices as well. So there's a Wirral workforce review and ongoing development. Then there's the Cheshire Merseyside, and then there's nationally as well. And I don't know, Simon, if you wanted to talk a bit more about the Wirral plans.
Well, actually, a little to add to that, apart from obviously we're looking at other non-clinical professionals coming into that domain as well. So you've got, as Nestor mentioned, social prescribers who will be able to take some of the sort of non-medical things that present medically. So the ability to put people in touch with things that will help them with their mental health and well-being that aren't necessarily drugs or other related therapies. In terms of the model itself, we are putting in over 1,000 extra appointments per week. And that is currently being covered by our two GP federations. As primary care networks develop, they'll be picking that up. And that's a really good thing, because primary care networks serving the neighbourhoods will have a closer affinity with those social prescribers, with the allied health professionals, such as paramedics and so on. But also what we're trying trying to do now through our workforce group is have a greater linkage with domiciliary care provision and with care homes and others. So actually, we look at the workforce as a whole. So we want to make health and care an attractive place for all people to work, and therefore go head to head with other opportunities such as global supermarkets, etc. So actually, we need to have people a career path that may start with working in care home and may end up being an allied health professional or a nursing assistant or beyond that in terms of providing one of the appropriate qualifications. So we have to be better at growing our own workforce as health and care provision going forward, and that's where the Cheshire Nurses Home work translates into Wirral. We're very fortunate in terms of Karen Howell, the Chief Executive of Wirral Health and Care, Community Health and Care NHS Foundation Trust is the lead for that work nationally and locally. So I think I'm quite comfortable at this time with the capacity and capability putting in terms of extended GP access. In terms of our GP practices generally, we have high levels of employment within them. The workforce has substantially changed, as we know. There is a movement away from the practice model rather than practice models to exist. Many younger GPs wish to work in a more flexible way, and actually extended hours offers them the opportunity to work more flexibly around their families and around the opportunities that those additional shifts bring. So I think we're never complacent, and we'll keep this under constant review, but we're a fairly good place in terms of the coverage of this, because we have GP coverage and nurses coverage as well.
To hear that general direction of travel, but my challenge to all of you would be how quickly can we get going with this. I think there are some amazing and very innovative models that are already out there being trialled now, looked at. I don't know if you're just country file, but there was one 2 weeks ago looking at rural GPs and some of the flexibilities that they are now dealing with, and their driver was being able to, very, very sparse, spread out community, just can't get to patients. So rather than dragging patients to the practice, how can we get the care to the patients wherever they might be? And, some of the technology that we carry around with us is hugely helpful. I think there's flexible working patterns where, GPs with all sorts of personal and caring issues might be quite happy to do 3 hours a day, but can't do a full shift.